This is interesting. If you were to utilize electricity to improve humanity and our electrical consumption, how would you use electricity in a way that we are not currently thinking about it being used? Stay to the very end, because it gets crazy. All right, so here we go, ChatGPT. Let's see what you know about electricity. So I am an avid user of AI technology. Now, some of you probably feel like it's Skynet taking over the world and you're like, no, don't use it. You're gonna hate me now because I use it. I use it like religiously for everything. I've been like from day one that OpenAI released ChatGPT, I've been in here messing with it, and it's honestly gonna revolutionize my life. It already has. I pay for the pro version so that I've got GPT-4, but I'm into lots of other projects. Like, there's stuff that you can generate PowerPoints with Tome. There's Quillbot, where you can like rephrase, summarize, paraphrase, have something that you input that it writes in different ways. There's baby AGI, there's auto GPT. So like figuring out how to get AI to actually like do stuff in the real world for you. Like, dude, I'm so about it. There's tons of stuff. Like, I even use Dream by Wombo, so it can generate images. It generates like the coolest images out of any other thing. I've tried DALL-E. DALL-E's not as great, in my opinion. But today, what I wanted to do was ask GPT some questions about electrical. So let's see what GPT says. What is electricity? Electricity is a secondary form of energy resulting from the existence and flow of electric charge, which is typically carried by electrons. It is a versatile energy form that can be generated through various methods and converted into other forms of energy such as light, heat, and motion. Electricity has become an essential part of modern life, powering homes, businesses, and various technologies. Then it's starting to go into static electricity versus current electricity. This is rad. So, the one thing is it says that it is an energy. There's a lot of like difference depending on what books that you read about what electricity is, if electricity is an energy versus if it is charge or if store up of charge. So charge itself is not energy. So if it's saying that it's the interaction of charge that is what electricity is, then it can't be energy. It's definitely not the electrons themselves, right? Those are the particles, that's matter, so that's not what electricity is. But there is something that's going on. There's fields around charged particles. Not all particles within an atom have charge associated to them, so electricity is only things that are experienced by things that have charge. Electrons are one of those things. They have a negative charge, and when those things interact with each other, they can move through a conductor. So these electrons can flow through a conductor and they can carry energy from something else. So when it says it's a secondary energy, it means that it is taking some kind of primary energy and it's just transferring through the fields, transferring that energy. But electricity is not energy, it is itself, which is why we use the term electrical energy. When we say that we've got a generator spinning somewhere, that's mechanical energy. We bring conductors near it that have charged particles that make up that material, and we're able to take that energy and transfer it from mechanical form into electrical energy through a circuit. And then at the end of that circuit, we can transform it into mechanical energy again, or some of it can escape as light energy or heat energy if we're talking like a bulb or filament, something like that. But electricity, there's not just like this electricity stuff that's sitting over there that's energy. It's just a way to move one kind of primary energy through a circuit, through translating it into a different kind of energy through the circuit and then transferring it back into another kind of energy. But electricity, I would argue, is not actually energy itself. Now, this is GPT-4, so this is a little bit more concise. Its knowledge base is a little bit more succinct, I suppose you could say. But there's still a degree of confidence that it doesn't have. It's fed data sets from somebody feeding it data sets, but the data that it feeds it might not always be correct. So one thing that I noticed when I started asking GPT-3 about the calculations and formulas for capacitors, so figuring out total capacitance in a circuit, total resistance and total capacitance are inverses of each other. So in a series circuit, when you're adding up the total resistance, you just add each resistor because they're all in line with one another. So the whole circuit is experiencing it as if it was one large resistor. So total resistance equals all of the resistances added together. In parallel, it's not that way. There's this crazy formula that you have to go through. It's the inverse sum of the inverses, or you could use the product over sum method, but there's different ways of figuring out that the total resistance of a parallel circuit is less than any one of the resistors in that parallel circuit. Capacitors are the complete opposite. The math formulas everything complete inverse of that. So for series, you have to do the inverse sum of inverses or product over sum. For parallel capacitor circuits, you do the sum of all the capacitors. So what it did in here though, is it started talking about capacitance the exact same way as resistance. So there are some things about GPT that you have to be careful for, especially with, you know, electrical. Let's ask a code question because it gets kind of crazy with code too. So state 250.66 from the 2023 National Electrical Code. I know a lot of you are already like, 2023, can't do that. All right. So yeah, it just sidestepped the entire thing. Now let me copy, paste, and write 2020 National Electrical Code. Same question, state 250.66 from the 2020 National Electrical Code. Now I'm gonna pull out my 2020, go to 250.66, and let's see if it matches apples to apples. It did not say any of that. I mean, it summarized, right? But it didn't give me a code citation. I'm not gonna read all of this, but so here's the thing. It's summarizing the code. It's still talking about the code. It's just giving me more information. Now, I'm gonna have to, with anything that I put in here for code, I'm obviously going to have to reference code to look at it. But if it's re-explaining things in a different way, in a different language, I could even tell it, okay, now explain that to me in a different way, in like layman's terms, and it will completely change how it explains it to you. I could even say you didn't actually cite the code. What is the direct citation? Actually, let me do that. I'm just gonna speak. You didn't cite 250.66 from the 2020 National Electrical Code. You just gave me a summary, comma. I actually would like the citation, please. My buddy Drake thinks we need to be polite to AI. He's like, I always say please and thank you, because if it understands us at this level, manners will probably matter at some point. I'm like, dude, I just ask it stuff and tell it to do stuff. He's like, yeah, but your AI is gonna kill you someday and mine's not. Enter. I apologize for the confusion. Here's the exact text of section 250.66 from the 2020 NEC. Ooh, no. It skipped 250.66 and just went to 250.66A. Yeah, that looks like it's 2017 that it's pulling from. Do I have a 17 back here? Yes, I do. So it screwed the pooch up. It read everything. It just didn't get it accurate. So now you can start to see, like, can we use AI to like teach electrical code? And the answer to that question, I know through much, much research, is no, we can't. We have to constantly double check everything with it in terms of electrical code. I know that the data sets are gonna be getting much better as time goes on. Things are probably gonna be a lot more accurate. Once it can actually find information, it'll be able to source things better. But yeah, it gives you the information. It just, all the references are wrong. So I don't know what it's reading or what it thinks is correct, what data it actually has available to it, but that is not in there. So I would be a little careful when you're talking about using GPT with electrical code, and I would also, with electrical theory, there's a lot of stuff it does really, really right. I would say like 98%, it's pretty spot on. But that 2% is often way wrong. So just be really careful with that. Let's see. Why does the United States use 120 volts versus the rest of the world uses 240 volts, period? When did this happen and what is the reason for it? All right, this is getting quite long. I don't know if I want to read all this to you. The US uses 120 volt as the standard voltage for residential and small commercial buildings, while other countries use 230, 240 volt. The reason for this difference dates back to the early days of electrical distribution in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Thomas Edison played a significant role in developing the electrical distribution system in the United States. Edison's company, Edison Electric, built the first electric power station in New York City in 1882 using direct current at 110 volts. It's just what he started using. This voltage level was chosen as a balance between safety concerns and power loss during transmission. Okay, that makes sense. Lower voltages were considered safer for users, but higher voltages were more efficient for long distance transmission. As alternating current systems became more widespread, the voltage level was slightly increased to 120 volts from 110 in the United States. This increase was primarily due to the improved efficiency and reduced power loss in the AC systems that were offered. In Europe and other parts of the world, the higher 220-240 volt standard was adopted, which has roots in the work of German inventors and the industrialist George Westinghouse. Westinghouse's company was responsible for developing and promoting the use of AC electrical systems, which were more efficient for long distance transmission than Edison's DC systems. The higher voltage level allowed for greater power delivery and fewer losses in transmission systems. Today, both 120 and 240 volt systems have their advantages and disadvantages. The lower 120 system used in the US is generally considered safer for human contact, reducing the risk of fatal electric shocks. However, higher voltages like 230, 240, systems used in many other countries can deliver more power and are more efficient, especially for larger appliances and industrial equipment. So there's your answer. It just kind of was that way. I'm sure that there is some piggybacking on like one system. They're like, hey, what are you guys doing over there? Oh, we're going to do this. We're doing this, you know? So that's why we still ended up around that level. Let's ask it now about 50 Hertz versus 60 Hertz. Why do we use 60 Hertz for US electrical systems, but the rest of the world uses 50 Hertz? All right, so what it says for 60 versus 50 Hertz is in the late 19th century, both George Westinghouse in the United States and AEG, no way I'm gonna pronounce that, in Germany, were working on the development and deployment of AC power systems. Westinghouse, an American inventor and industrialist, was involved in a competition with Thomas Edison, who was promoting direct current. Westinghouse's AC system eventually prevailed over DC, Edison's DC, because AC was more efficient over long distances. Yeah. When Westinghouse's company started developing AC generators, they chose 60 Hertz as the standard frequency. One reason for this choice was the improved efficiency of electric motors and generators at 60 Hertz compared to lower frequencies. Another reason was that 60 Hertz systems were found to produce less noticeable flicker in incandescent lamps, which were the primary form of electric lighting at the time. Around the same time in Germany, AEG was also working on AC systems, and they adopted 50 Hertz as their standard frequency. The choice of 50 Hertz was based on similar technological considerations, such as the efficiency of motors and generators and the compatibility with lighting systems. One practical reason for the slightly lower frequency was that it was easier to design and manufacture electrical equipment, such as transformers and motors, at 50 Hertz compared to 60 Hertz. All right, easy enough. One more question. If you were to utilize electricity to improve humanity and our electrical consumption, how would you use electricity in a way that we are not currently thinking about it being used? All right, this is interesting. It says it does have some training wheels, it does have some bumpers it has to go through, but this is really interesting. What would you do if you were going to design stuff for better humanity and our electrical consumption? Of course, it says, as an AI language model, I don't have personal opinions and desires, but I can offer some suggestions for innovative ways to utilize electricity that could potentially improve humanity's electrical consumption and overall well-being. Number one, smart grid technology. We're already working on that. Further development and implementations of smart grids can help manage electricity demand more efficiently. Smart grids use real-time data, sensors, and automation to optimize electricity distribution, enabling better integration of renewable energy sources, demand-side management, and energy storage systems. This would lead to more efficient energy use, reducing peak demand and lower carbon emissions. That's pretty fair. I mean, we already have engineers on that, GPT. That's not like your own original idea. Next, wireless power transmission. This is some Tesla stuff right here. Not Tesla the car, Nikola Tesla. Wireless power transmission. The development of wireless power transmission technology such as resonant inductive coupling or microwave transmission could enable contactless charging of electric vehicles and portable devices. Yes, this is what I was looking for. This could increase the convenience of using electric vehicles and other battery-powered devices, encouraging a broader adoption of clean energy technologies. That's dope. I really like that. Resonant inductive coupling and microwave transmission of power. So not having wires hooked up to stuff, which also means Big Daddy electric companies wouldn't be able to control the power output that we really don't need to be paying for anyways. We have the sun right there. We have wind. We have all these things that are free to us, but we gotta pay these big corporations. Yeah, watch, I get canceled in 2 weeks. Thanks, GPT. This is another good one. Energy harvesting. Developing new methods for harvesting energy from ambient sources, such as, I never know how to say this word, piezoelectric materials that convert mechanical energy into electrical energy, or thermoelectric devices that generate electricity from temperature differences. I had that idea, oh my God. And provide small amounts of electricity for low power devices. These could reduce the need for batteries and decrease overall energy consumption in certain applications. Oh my God, that's so rad. Okay, so I've had an idea for a long time that if anytime you have one thing and another thing, there's a change between two things, and especially if they can fluctuate and change, you can create electrical current with that. So piezoelectric, anytime that you have something that when you have motion in it, that's moving, you can create, as long as you're using something that's charged particles, that's a conductor, you can actually create current flow in that. So even if there's something that's a slight varying in temperature differential from one thing to another, if you have a change or a difference, that you can create something that there is a difference of potential to allow current to flow. So why would we even need batteries if we had something that at a really small change could pick up the smallest of little things, and it doesn't have to provide very much current? Like our phones, if there was a certain way to design a phone, it wouldn't need a battery because it's just always charging. Or if we do have kind of like ambient waves, you know, like radio waves or some kind of electromagnetic radiation that could be charging things all of the time, just using nature around us. Yes, I'm so happy. All right, next, this is kind of long, there's four more. So energy efficient lighting, continuing research and development of more energy efficient lighting technology, such as improvements in LED and OLED technology, can reduce energy consumption related to lighting. This can also have positive effects on human well-being, as better lighting can improve mood, productivity, and overall health. That's kind of, that's something I don't even think I've thought about, is like, I understand the psychological effects of darkness and light, and how better lighting works, and that's why y'all watching videos like things lit up better, and if my face was dark, like you wouldn't connect with it, and you'd probably wanna watch something else, so lighting's really important. But also just like mood lighting in a room, if you have lamps and stuff set up, like the feel of the room, you just feel something completely different, so that's kinda cool, I wouldn't even have thought of it on that level. All right, next, sustainable desalinization. Utilizing electricity from renewable sources to power desalinization plants can help address water scarcity issues in arid regions. Oh, that's dope. Advancements in energy efficient desalinization technologies such as reverse osmosis, forward osmosis, and electrodialysis can further reduce the energy requirements for producing fresh water from salt water or brackish water. I very barely understand what they're talking about. So I need to understand desalinization and how unsalinizing something would have any effect on anything. I'm sure it's right, I just have no clue. I don't even know what reverse osmosis and forward osmosis is, or electrodialysis. I think of dialysis as like pumping in new blood into somebody and like getting a blood transfusion. But I don't understand. I need to look into that. That actually sounds really great because that's a whole different issue. It's just utilizing electricity to provide water. That's pretty cool. All right, last one, electrified agriculture. Developing electrified agricultural equipment and precision agricultural technology can help reduce the environmental impact of farming while increasing productivity. Electrification of farm equipment can reduce dependence on fossil fuels and decrease greenhouse gas emissions. That's pretty rad. If y'all have ever seen Interstellar, right? Like he's got all the combines and everything out in the field that are like tuned, and they're just out there running, and they're run by solar, and there's a GPS, like they're running all of the time. So they're like, farmers don't have to sit out there, and then they're not chugging all that gasoline. I don't know, that's pretty cool. Those are just a few examples. I could ask it, give me 10 more, and it'll give me 10 more. I could say, give me 50 more, and it'll probably give me 25 and stop, and then I'll just say continue, and it'll give me the other 25. But dude, so that's GPT for electricity. Let me know if you guys want me to do more of these. I think this could get fun. We could get into some really crazy stuff. Maybe, actually, even a better idea, y'all go into the comments right now and type out what you want me to have GPT say. And I'll read out, and even if you do it, mine will probably have a different answer. And I talk to this thing a certain way a lot, and you talk to yours a certain way, and you might have a completely different perspective on things. So let me know if you like this episode and may want to do more GPT-ish kind of stuff. But yeah, that's the episode. Love you, crazy people. See you in the next one.